Hello, everyone, and welcome to the second event in the series Tuesdays in Rome, a celebration of 50 years of Trinity College Rome campus. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Stephen Marth. I've been the director, or I am the current director of Trinity College Rome campus, and I've been here since 2017. I'd like to begin by thanking so many of you for joining us last month for the first event and for being here today. Many thanks to our colleagues in the Office of Alumni Relations and the Office of Study Away who have been central to the organization of these events. During today's event, feel free to use the chat function to speak to one another or with us. And at the end of the conversation, we'll make time for questions and answers. So you can put your questions in the Q&A function during the event and we'll try to get to them at the end. So for me, it is truly a delight to introduce tonight's speakers, three men whom I greatly esteem, who I closely associate with our program's long history and success, and who have been very supportive and welcoming to me personally in my move to Trinity 4 years back. Two of them, Professor Emeritus of Chemistry and former Dean Henry DePhillips, and Professor Emeritus of History, former Dean and twice President Borden Painter, have played an essential role in supporting and guiding the program from the home campus over the years. In a moment, they will tell you about this experience and will be joined by another extremely important figure for our program, Professor of Renaissance and Baroque Art History, Livio Pestilli, whom anyone who studied with Trinity College Rome campus from around 1978 until just a few years ago would know as the Rome Campus Director. So I'll leave the stage to them and we'll join you again at the end for a question and answer session.
Thank you, Steve. I'll kick things off as the sort of senior member here in the Senate. Not only am I old, but I go back with memories of the Rome campus before it began. In the late 60s, going out to lunch often with Mike Campo, we'd walk over to New Britain Avenue to one of the Italian bakeries for a bite to eat for lunch. And Mike would talk about his dream of opening a program in Italy and in Rome. Mike, of course, knew Italy so well, its history and culture, but he had an instinct, I think, for where to put the program. Not another one in Florence, not going off to Venice or some regional town, but Rome, the greatest really city in many ways in world history. And no one commissioned Mike to start the program. This was his idea. Mike was a great entrepreneur and improviser, and he was the one who got this program started. And the college finally backed him, and off he went to Rome to search for a campus site. He was aided by the man we called the mysterious Mr. Mouchet of Lavinia Tour. Lavinia works a lot with religious houses. So Mike was shown many different locations in Rome, usually owned by one of the orders. And as Mike told it to me, Mouchet said, well, there is this place in the Aventine he didn't think was suitable, but Mike, we'll go take a look. Well, so Mike had his sort of Brigham Young moment, you know, when he walked in and said, this is the place. This Camaldolese convent on the Aventine Hill. And for those of you who went on the program there, you know what a wonderful location the Aventine is. Wonderful residential area, Santa Sabina, the 5th century church, all kinds of interesting buildings, and yet well located in Rome. The old 94 bus would get you downtown quickly and so on. And so the program began in 1970. As I think we noted in the first program, everything that could go wrong in that first summer did. And Mike was up to it. He was not only running the program on campus with over 100 students, but with a component out doing an archaeological program where nothing was ready when they got there, where the archaeologists didn't speak English, on and on and on. Mike loved to improvise. Things that would make most of us faint would just be a challenge to Mike. And so he got through that first summer with flying colors, teaching all the time, being with the students, And of course, assisted by his wife, Inez. Inez and the four kids were there, I think both the first and second summer. Inez, whom I saw many times over the years in Rome, was the world's best packer, among other things. She could pack all these things up and off they would go to Rome and sort of take care of Mike a little bit behind the scenes, but also interacting with students. And later, when we started the elder hostel programs for senior citizens who educational program, she would mix with them and always had tips on where to go shopping. Would often lead people on shopping tours and one thing and another, and just did a wonderful job. My first experience directly was in the second summer, 1971, when I went and taught a couple of courses. And again, the convent was crowded. I shared a room with a student in what later became one of the offices. And it went quite well. Again, there were problems. I went back in 74 and directed the summer program. That was the last year that we had the archaeological program. I can remember driving out to Cerveteri, and I was, of course, kind of panicky about driving in Rome. And I had this VW bus, but I soon realized that with all these little Cinquecentos around, I was bigger than they were, and they respected me. So I grew in confidence as I made my way around Rome. And you never knew what you'd see in Rome. I know the first summer in 71 when I taught, and the program had ended and I had a few extra days, I visited different places in Rome. One day I was coming down the Spanish Steps and they were filming Fellini's film Roma. And this tan guy with nothing on but a loincloth was standing in the middle of the Spanish Steps with his arms upraised, which I later saw in the film. In fact, I remember another time later when we were in Trastevere one evening taking a walk and Fellini was there filming. And Inez she went right up and started talking to him. And she and Mike and Fellini had quite a conversation. Later in 96, when we were doing an alumni program, we went up to Spoleto for the day. And that's one of the sites for the festival, the two cities. And we spotted Giancarlo Menotti. And again, Inez went right up and we had a wonderful conversation. He took us in the theater and showed us around. It was quite an experience. You never knew what was going to happen with the Campos and with our time in Rome. Later, I had the honor of being director of Italian programs and spending two semesters in the fall of 96 and 2000 in Rome. One other event I'll mention, some of you may remember, in 91, with the Gulf War, the program had to be canceled. But at the very last minute, I mean, literally the war started, I can remember seeing it on TV that evening. And we had to swing into action because most of the students were leaving the next morning. Few had already gone over. And I and Rob Winslow, who was one of the administrators, got on the phone and called people and told them the program had to be canceled. That semester, Phyllis English, who many of you remember in the program, came and taught at Trinity. And Alden Gordon in the finance department was going to teach that semester. And he got what I call the Saddam Hussein scholarship grant because there he was in Rome. He could do his research, no teaching responsibilities. And he got away with it, not bad, good for him. Occasionally students loved Italy so much they never went home. And one of them, I think, maybe tuned in today, Gwyneth Bird. Gwyneth is class of 97. And she stayed in Italy and married an Italian, is raising a family there. She couldn't even leave the neighborhood. She works at the Food and Agricultural Organization, the FAO, as some of you remember, that huge fascist building at the end of the Viale Aventino. At the foot of the Circus Maximus. Needless to say, it's been a wonderful 50 years. It's too bad we couldn't celebrate in Rome last March, but maybe next year. In the meantime, this is a great opportunity for many of us to get together. I'm going to turn it over to Henry now and let him tell you a little bit about his involvement with all things Roman.
Hi, everyone. It's really a privilege for me to be here. I'm just going to take a few minutes of your time to tell you how I became involved. How does a chemist become involved in a wonderful art history-based program in Rome? Well, it all began in 1983, and not surprisingly, wherever my campo is concerned, it took place on a tennis court. Mike and I were partners for many, many years in a doubles match, and he said to me in 1983, "Why don't you teach a course in Rome?" So I said to him, "Sure, Mike, I'd love to do that. I'll teach general chemistry." Well, Mike is a very nice person, was a very nice person, and he wouldn't have sworn at me, but I know that if he could have, he would have, because he looked at me very pathetically and he said, "Henry, you have to teach a course that somehow will include the city of Rome itself." So I thought to myself, I had just read three articles in a chemistry journal on art conservation and some of the chemical principles behind the kinds of methodologies they were using to conserve and restore paintings. So I said to Mike, "Listen, I think I can put something together that you would approve." And over the next couple of weeks, I certainly did that. And in 1983, during the summer program, I did teach a course in art conservation. The next milestone for me was in 1986. Again, it took place on a tennis court when the head of conservation at the Wadsworth Athenaeum, a museum I'm sure many of you know, is the oldest public museum in the United States. And Steve said to me, "Henry, I have some pigments I'd love to have analyzed, and I know you're a chemist. Can you do that?" Well, it just so happens that my father owned a chemical company, and I worked for him for about 5 or 6 years. And pigments were a simple component in all paints, as well as artist paints. Well, I did, in fact, decide at that point in 1986 that the analysis of pigments was a lot more interesting than a lot of the chemistry I was doing on the respiratory proteins in vertebrates, and humans. So I changed my entire direction of my research and I became what's called now a conservation scientist. Then the third component and last leg of this journey occurred in 2004 when my wife and I were visiting Rome, and we had known Livio Pestilli and Wendy, his wife, for many years since 1983. And one evening we were out and Livio said to me, "Henry, why don't you teach an art conservation course in our Rome program during the summer?" So I agreed to do that. And I did put a course together. The title of it was Science in Art. And I taught that course for a period of 9 consecutive summers. Now, of course, an art conservation is such an important subject that is included integrally with the semester program in Trinity College Rome program. So, why am I so enthusiastic about teaching art conservation, especially teaching art conservation in Rome? Well, let's consider a typical science course. It consists of a lecture component and a lab component. That is exactly how I decided I would frame my course for the Rome program. Some in-class discussion of art, conservation principles, followed by a laboratory using the city of Rome as my lab. Each day after class, and of course, after an espresso at a local bar, I arranged to visit either an ongoing conservation project or a completed conservation project, such as the Sistine Chapel, the Fontana di Trevi, the bronze statue of Marcus Aurelius in the Capitoline Museum, or several of the seven Caravaggio paintings that are located in Rome, some of which had been cleaned and restored and others that were in the process of restoration. So that was the laboratory for my course. Now, we all know that slides and digital photos of those same artworks can bring their presence into a classroom, but to see them in person and to hear of their conservation and restoration by those who actually did the work is a truly unique and unforgettable experience. That is the reason I love teaching that science and art course in Rome, and I think the students learned what it takes to bring an artwork back to a condition as close as possible to the condition it was in when completed by the artist. So, not surprisingly, I have a number of people to thank for the privilege of teaching the course I love in Rome. And at the top of that list is my friend and colleague, Livio Pestilli. Take it away, Livio.
Am I on the screen?
You are.
I am, okay. Hello, everyone, and greetings from Paris. You can see the Tour Eiffel right behind me. I figured I would remind you of one of the great places of Rome that you, I'm sure, frequented while you were here. I want to thank all the participants this evening and even the previous gathering two Tuesdays ago for your affectionate messages and your friendship throughout the years. I want you to know that the feeling is mutual. We all do our job in Rome with dedication and love for the city and for it, the students who come here. My years at Trinity, 37 as a director and still going. I'm basically blessed because in my life I've had two wonderful marriages, one with my wife Wendy and the other with Trinity College. I couldn't have been luckier, and I certainly I feel I've gotten the best of both worlds, or at least it keeps me in contact with both worlds. My first recollection, of course, goes back to the time in the summer of 77 when my wife and I came back to Italy. I have written to Michael Campo asking if he needed a teacher of English literature, because I have a master's in English lit. And he told me that I should come to the Aventine Hill and we should discuss the subject. So I did, and it was my first time on the Aventine. I left for the States when I was a young man and came back in 77, as I said. So when I got up to the Aventine and walked up this kind of inconspicuous and somewhat desolate, or I should say remote, Clivo dei Pubblici, once I walked into the convent, it was like one of Montale's poems, you know, these trees, these flowers, the gorgeous landscape around the premises of the convent itself. And Mike sat in the back garden waiting for me. And we began talking, and he told me that, of course, for that particular fall, you know, the semester was about to begin, there was no work for me, but if I stayed in touch with him, I might have a course to teach in the spring of 78. Well, that was the beginning of my lifetime connection with Trinity. In the spring of 78, I taught one course in Italian, not English lit, but Italian language course. The following semester, I taught two Italian courses, and the third semester, three courses. So by the fall of 1979, I was teaching three courses, but I was also lucky enough to be selected as the next on-site director of the program. And of course, my recollections of Michael, just had a few incidents that kind of bring us back to the founder of the program. Mike and I took a bunch of trips together also with our wives, with Inez and Wendy. We drove to Ravello, the Amalfi Drive, the Umbria, especially Spoleto, where we Mike introduced me to Strozza Preti and Tartufo. Some of you know what that is all about. And we went to a picnic in Abruzzo. And the one funny story pertaining to our trips together, he and I went out to the Puglia region near Foggia because an alumnus wanted to donate a property to Trinity College. And so we went down, you know, to take a look at this property. Well, it was the kind of property that's fit for goats and sheep, but not necessarily for students. It was on an incline with rocks all over the place. And so we turned the, very graciously, I'd say, the offer down, but that was one of the many trips that we took together. Nonetheless, perhaps the most memorable, if scary, trip we took together was the 1980 trip down to southern Italy after the earthquake in the Campania region hit very hard. And two of our students were stranded there. Some of you know them, or perhaps the Carol Pastorelli, Trinity College, and Virginia Tortolani, who I know were connected last time. I'm not sure if they are connected this evening. From Brown University, they were stranded out there. And Mike and I went, as I said, drove all the way down with my little Alfa Sud, and we were able to bring them back to Rome to everyone's happy memories. I should, I divided my comments, and if there are questions or if I'm going on too long, some of you maybe just flag me and stop me. But I divided the comments. I start out with the nuns, then with some historic events, and then finally with the memories or of some events that took place that it involved our students. And I'm sure perhaps that's the part that interests you the most. We had a great rapport, and we still do, with the nuns, but occasionally I realized that we were living on two different planets. The first incident that kind of shocked me was in, I think, in the early 80s. One morning I walked onto campus and I found the furnace, the boiler, was in the middle of the courtyard. And nobody had alerted me that this was going to take place. And so basically for a couple of weeks, we had to put students in a hotel. And the ongoing fight with the furnace was, as so many students will remember, is that of course both the heat and the hot water were on only for a couple hours in the morning and a couple hours in the evening. So some of the earlier students really led a Spartan life, not to mention the plastic paneling of the rooms, of the dorm rooms, which I call psychedelic plastic, and a number of other details that will come to mind. So we had, as I said, a great rapport with the nuns, but to assume that they understood us, it was a bit too much. That is, semester in, semester out, if they were not told every little detail in advance, they would not think that the same schedule we have been using for a number of semesters would be repeated. So another instance, and Borden Painter knows enough about this because he was involved as well. The day that our students arrived, I found out from Sister Lucia that she had rented out all the rooms for one day to another group. So you can imagine how happy we were about that decision. So we ended up here too, placing students in a nearby hotel and somehow surviving the event.
Yes, Suor Lucia, blessed memory, yes. Sometimes her memory failed her, and
yes,
we got through it.
Yeah, of course, one memory pertaining to the nuns, as well as the students, has to do with toilet seats. Now, some of the more recent students do not know what that means, but you have to think that for a good, well, from the inception of the program till about the late 1980s, I believe, our students woke up and went to the toilet and got cold cheeks first thing in the morning because there were no toilet seats at the convent. The nuns insisted that this was more sanitary, and we argued back and forth until finally Trinity decided to make the investment and they went along with us. And so fortunately for the more recent students, you now do not have to go through that particular experience. Another nun experience besides the nun buns, the rosette bread that we have here in Rome, which are wonderful first thing in the morning, but they turn into rubber by early afternoon. It has to do with the nuns cooking for our students. It was always a thorn in our side, especially mine, because I tried to coach them and tell them what to prepare for the students, but it was always a lost battle, especially if Mother Superior, especially if it was her turn to be in the kitchen for that particular week. You may not know, and some of you though may remember, that the nuns took their turns at the in the lobby, in the kitchen, washing dishes, tilling the land in the orchard in the back of the convent. And so their cooking was not always up to par. When Sister Maura was there, she was a phenomenal cook. But if Mother Superior was there for a whole week, we kind of suffered. The problem was ultimately solved when the catering team, the catering crew that we have now, began preparing their meals, at least lunches and sometimes also dinners for our students. And that goes back about 25, 28 years now. So we've been kind of fortunate. Relating to our meals, I won't go through the whole, the many changes that we went through. Originally, our students used to have three meals a day through the whole weekend, except for Sunday morning, when most likely they'd be away on a trip. But I've had very few great ideas in my life, but one of them was having coupons for our students. Instead of eating on campus, they could go out and have meals in nearby restaurants. But the best idea I ever had was to also approach Volpetti's grocery store on Via Marmorata and ask them if they would accept our coupons, and they did. And so students, ever since we began using them, find that Volpetti's indeed is one of the great bonuses of coming to our program. Since I'm on the topic of food, I might as well mention the Thanksgiving dinners, of course. I directed the program for 37 years and carved 36 turkeys. I missed one in 1996 when Borden took over for me in the fall of 96. And I have a confession to make. I can't stand turkey. I wish the pilgrims had found cattle way back in the 17th century instead of turkeys, because I would prefer a bistecca fiorentina anytime to a stuffed turkey. Anyway, just to give you some memories things that came to mind, I was jotting things down. The advantages of coming to the Rome program fall versus spring. Traditionally, there was an imbalance because the fall students would come, they would benefit by this wonderful family reunion of extended family, faculty members, staff, students, the students' family members who came to Italy during Thanksgiving, student friends and all that. We invite everybody to join us. And it was a beautiful festive occasion, and it still is. And the students then had 1 week vacation in the fall. In the spring instead, the students were in a sense cheated out of this wonderful extended family event, no Thanksgiving dinner, but they benefited by having a 2 week vacation, the week before Easter and the week after Easter. And the reason why it was worked out that way is because the nuns wanted to rent out their rooms to pilgrims who came to Rome for the Easter break, Easter vacation. Having 2 weeks vacation may sound like a better deal than just 1 week, but the problem was that the students had to clear out of the room. They had to move out of the rooms, put all their belongings in suitcases, stuff all the suitcases in one or two of the rooms on campus. And when they came back to Rome, they had to unpack everything and start all over again before the end of the program. Fortunately, that is no longer the case. We got over that about maybe 10, 15 years ago. So students nowadays don't have to go through that ordeal. I think I pretty much recollect the basic things that have to do with the nuns. Again, if they were not told exactly what was going to take place, they didn't do it. So if I didn't tell them that we needed meals the first weekend, they were not ready to prepare meals for us. Or they would rent out the lecture hall to other groups where we meet with the students and with the faculty on the first Sunday of the program. Anyway, so those are some of the ups and downs of working and living on the Aventine with the Camaldolese nuns. I will just briefly now just go through a few historic moments, historic events of the Rome program, and then I will just kind of wrap it up with some fun and some maybe amusing events that have to do with you students, former students and more recent ones. In 1978, spring of 78, that's when I began teaching at Trinity. And if you should come back to Rome and you go through our offices, you will find two or three photos pertaining to that event with Michael Campo and John Pope, Pope John Paul II. And in one of them, I'm there as well with a nice turtleneck and a jacket. Now, both the turtleneck and the jacket were not really mine. Wally Salampo, one of the faculty members who resided on the premises, lent me both the jacket and the turtleneck because I didn't know that the Pope was coming that day. And that was one of the great events for both the nuns and our students. And of course, Mike Campo did a wonderful job presenting the American program in Rome to the Pope. We've had some interesting people come and talk to our students through the years. For some of the older students, you remember, no doubt, the Roman actor Nino Manfredi, who was featured in the movie Bread and Chocolate. He came and talked to our students. Actually, he's dead now, but his family still owns, his wife still lives in the Gray Villa that's across from our convent, our campus, right across the little park. We also had Bernardo Bertolucci's brother, Giuseppe. Bernardo Bertolucci is the movie director who put out Last Tango in Paris, the movie 1900, and The Last Emperor. And I remember having to be the translator for both Giuseppe Bertolucci and for the students. And by the end of the talk, I was totally drained. I think I was probably running, if not a fever, certainly my blood pressure went up to about 200, because to be on your toes and translate almost simultaneously is quite a job. So that was. These are some of the people who came by that you might know about and remember. Roberto Benigni, of course, some of you, again, not so much the more recent student, but Roberto Benigni is the actor who in 1996, I think it was, received an Oscar for the best foreign movie, Life is Beautiful, La Vita è Bella. And the amusing anecdote connected with Benigni was that I had a golden retriever, Stanley, and Stanley would come on campus and sometimes also into the classroom and take notes along with the students. But one of our students, I mentioned to her mother that Professor Pestilli has this dog that comes around, so on and so forth, this golden retriever. And so her mother then came to Italy, and on the way from the airport to the convent, right next to the convent was Roberto Benigni, who at that time was living on the Aventine. Roberto Benigni, who also had a golden retriever. And so as the mother of the student got out of the taxi, she went up to Roberto Benigni and she said, Professor Pestilli, I'm so-so's mother. And Roberto Benigni responded, says, I'm not sure who Professor Pestilli is, but I'm Roberto Benigni. And the student, of course, was, when she told me, she felt totally humiliated, but I think it was such a funny story that all of the students who know Roberto Benigni is, I'm sure, would get a kick out of it. some more serious events, historical events, have to do the so-called leaden years. Again, the older students will remember the term. The late 70s and the early 80s, all over Europe, but especially Italy and Germany, lots of terrorists were running around, kneecapping people, journalists, judges, political figures, and in some instances, killing them as well. And so the Italian extreme leftist group that kind of headed this movement was called the Red Brigades. And when they began being a bit too active in Italy, that's the first time I removed the school's plaque, the school's name, from the front door of the convent. Anonymity was the name of the game at that point. And to this day, we don't publicize on our door where we are. I mean, people can find out quite easily, but at least we don't publicize that this is where American students are located. But right at that time, the counterpart of the Red Brigades were called, well, they're different names, but one of them was the Baader-Meinhof. And when the nuns, when we did not occupy all the rooms at the convent, the nuns would rent out those rooms to make some extra money. And for about a week or so, a young German man, I think it was room number 35, he was placed there because the room was empty. And one day he left, and that very evening, the Italian anti-terrorist police, I was told I wasn't there because it was in the wee hours of the night, they came with machine guns in hand looking for this guy. The nuns had to open up that room 35, I think it was. And fortunately for him, and perhaps even for us, the young man had left. But this is one of the more dramatic moments that we live on the premises. Borden Painter mentioned the 1991 cancellation of the program, but even prior to that, in 15th of April 1986, Gaddafi, the ruler of Libya, bombed the Italian island of Lampedusa, south of Sicily. And that fall, the enrollments dropped. Well, I should say that spring, five students went back home. The parents were very concerned. Obviously, they didn't know how close Lampedusa or how far Lampedusa is from Rome. But five students were called back by their parents. And the ensuing fall, then the following fall, we had one of the smallest groups ever. Only 23 students attended the program. We also had, as a preface to what Borden Painter mentioned, the 1991 Gulf War, December 21st, 1988, the Pan Am Flight 103 flying from Frankfurt to Detroit via London and New York was blown up by terrorist groups connected with Saddam Hussein over Lockerbie, Scotland. There were 243 casualties, 190 US citizens died, and most of these were Syracuse University London students returning home at the end of the fall program. So you can understand why I remember being on the phone with Borden Painter the night before, two nights before the actual cancellation of the program, where we could see on CNN News the American planes bombing Baghdad. And what came to mind, of course, was Lockerbie. And we said, we just can't have a program. So I think just about the only program that literally canceled, we incurred, and so did the nuns, a tremendous financial setback. But as always, and as anyone should, we put the safety of our students first and foremost. Since I'm talking about bombings, I might as well finish it off with the fall 1995 bombing of former Yugoslavia by the Europeans and American coalition. And at that time, five students left also under parental pressure. On the map, Yugoslavia and Italy look terribly close together. And I suppose any parent looking at the map would feel very uncomfortable having a child studying in Italy. Just as a well, penultimate, last, second to the last kind of historic event. On January 31st, 2001, I was personally threatened with an anonymous letter sent to me at my home address by the Nuclei Combattenti Comunisti. They were not the Red Brigades, but they were sympathizers. And a five-page letter, all mimeographed with the five-pointed star, and accusing me of being a tool of American imperialism. The same threat was sent over to the director of St. John's University, and also a copy of the letter went to the US Embassy. This is when I also removed my name from the doorbell and the PA system downstairs in the building, and I got my name off the telephone book. I just didn't want to be a soft target for these terrorists, because they might not go after the ambassador, but they could easily hit someone who's directing an American program. And just finally, the tragic death of two of our students. There's a hole in my heart. Since the spring of 1987, when we lost Jeff Shard, the spring of 87, and then the spring of 2014, John Durking. Both students had awful deaths that have hurt us. And as I said, a shock to our community. And I want to say hello to John and Sharon Shard, whom I know are listening this evening. As always, we've been in touch since 87. One of the good things that came out of that tragic event is we become very close, wonderful friends. And we're on basically a weekly email contact. And so, ciao, Sharon, ciao, John. Love to both of you. And of course, the Durkins, I notice on the list, are not here this evening, but the same go out to them as well. Students, so I'll kind of conclude, although I got about three, four pages of notes here. And if I could carry on too long, Henry or Borden, you know, just, you know, tell me time out and whatnot. The 1970 streaking event you heard about last week, I think, or 2 weeks ago, but that was before my time.
And you were not involved.
No, I wasn't born yet. some humorous events, and someone I think I mentioned on the chat line last week or 2 weeks ago. We used to take our students at the very first weekend. Michael Campo, the very first evening that he brought students over, would take them to the Capitoline Hill and Nocturnal Walk, trying to let them prevent them from falling asleep so they could quickly get into the schedule. And the first weekend, along the same line of reasoning, we take our students to nearby towns. And one semester, we were taking students to Umbria, to Orvieto. And the bus dropped us off at the bottom of the hill. And we were taking the funicular going up to the hill. And there were a bunch of students, and I was amongst them. But I was covered by another student, as a male student started saying that that day that his goal was for the semester was to take a shower and go to the toilet at the same time. And I said to myself, oh boy, we're in for a good one this semester. But I presume that a number of you have had the same inclination, given that everything is right there, very convenient, but that perhaps not ideal in certain circumstances, especially if you forget to remove the toilet paper. We mentioned the toilet seats, but one of the funny things that would occur from time to time, some of you older students do not know perhaps that the main classroom we ended up calling the red classroom because there were red chairs in there. Well, that room was a little bit longer years back. We shortened that to make room for the laundry room that's there now. But before the laundry room was created, students sometimes, without any shame, would walk in the back of the classroom as a class was being taught. They would go to the back of the room, open the door, and go and do their wash where we were trying to teach. So that was one of the great improvements we made to the premises was to wall off that section of the other premises so the students could do their laundry without going through our classroom. Another interesting story, but it pertains more to those of us who have to direct the program as far as the preparation that goes into the rooming of our students. And some of you may not know, but it took me a while to figure out that I had to give all the rooms that face the park outside the convent, I would have to place boys in there and the girls in the rooms that face the convent courtyard. And that's because on and off, we would have exhibitionists displaying themselves to our girls who were possibly even hanging their clothes from the shutters. And so that became a trick that I learned early on and passed on to our current director, Stephen Marth. Make sure you keep the girls on the inside part of the convent and not expose them to the weirdos who not only exhibit themselves, of course, in the park, but many of you may have had experiences coming up Clivo dei Pubblici and having some of these weirdos appear out of nowhere. Let's see, Joanna Pitocelli, I think you're listening, you're connected this evening. I still remember the fall of 1980 when you were jogging and you were down by the cafe, which is now closed, but across from the tobacconist on Via Laventino, the intersection there. And a scippatore, someone who normally would go for either a purse or a necklace, came up to you and tried to remove your gold chain, your gold necklace. He didn't know that you were physically fit. And you grabbed a hold of him and just about beat the hell out of the kid and save his own life. I remember he removed his sweater, which you were holding onto, and ran away. So that is one event that has stuck with me from the early years. The other amusing thing, of course, is you all know our students tend to go out late at night and come back in the early hours of the morning. Well, in 1983, Jim Murren, who is now a very successful businessman in Las Vegas, he told me that, actually he's one of the trustees, I believe right now, Jim Murren. He reminded me how they used to come back home meaning the convent, maybe 3-4 o'clock in the morning, sometimes maybe even later. But our cleaning crew, the three girls, Giovanna, Anna, and Paola, would start cleaning the convent at 7 a.m. And the last thing they needed to hear, that is our students, is one of the girls shout down the hall, Giovanna! And the guys and the girls who had just come back from their outing would just kind of pull their hair out. With this kind of interaction with the cleaning crew. But let me turn for a second to some trips, especially the concrete trips, because a number of events occurred when in Capri. The most dramatic one, and I don't even remember the year, but it's got to be in the 1990s, early 1990s. We went to Capri and not infrequently students will come back late at night again and sometimes having imbibed a glass or two of vino, if not something even stronger. Well, one semester, one of the students who had drunk certainly more than his share ended up trespassing into a villa, going up to the second floor, going into a bedroom, where there were a husband, an elderly husband and wife team. The wife, by the way, turned out worked at FAO down the street from us. The husband was in his 70s, I think, and she was in his 60s. And this young man removed his clothes, except his underwear, fortunately, and he lay across the bed, right across their feet. And I can't tell you how excited we were, I was particularly, when the next day the hotel crew came, of course they called the owner, called the police. And it was obviously a big scandal. And we were fortunate that we were not sued because I think that kind of behavior would have warranted a stronger punishment. And I ended up in agreement with the college. And the student, it was only 3 weeks into the program. We sent him back home, but he was allowed to continue his studies at Trinity. Personally, I would have banned him totally. But anyway, that was a crazy event having to do with Capri. But Capri, and some of you may remember also Sorrento, also had its trials and tribulations. We had been in Capri only one semester when two of our students, not only walked on the trellis, and I got scolded by the hotel manager the next day, but supposedly removed a print, which the hotel did not find anymore. Consequently, we were ousted, were banned from going to Capri by the agency that we used. And we ended up going for a few semesters in Sorrento at the Hotel Augustus. Well, one semester, of course, students, there were a bunch of flagpoles in front of the hotel with flags of all nations, an international crowd. And two of those flags came down. Our students managed to climb up the pole and bring them back down. So that was another challenging experience we had with Capri and so on. In Anacapri, instead, on two different semesters, students, again, late at night, probably having drunk a bit too much, one semester in the 1990s, dumped a plastic chair and a plastic table into the pool. And if that weren't enough or bad enough, another semester, one of the students took a bronze lamp from the top of the building and dropped it down below three flights. So again, those were some of the trials and tribulations that you folks put me through. On one of those trips to Capri, it was also memorable because the whole group of students eventually got head lice. The students had gone on a trip, so I forget where, and stayed in a cheap hotel. Two or three students, they came back. Anyway, it went wild. A bunch of students had it. And so you can imagine what it was like for me to go to a pharmacy and ask for 40 combs and 40 bottles of shampoo, head lice shampoo. But that also kept us on our toes. One of the more amusing ones, and it shows how clever our students were and still are, before cell phones, we were on our way to Pompeii. And subsequently, of course, we went to Capri or Sorrento. And every time we'd stop at a pit stop, when we got back on the bus, we'd count, of course, the number of people on the bus to make sure we didn't forget anyone. Well, one semester we messed up, we miscounted. We took off after the pit stop for Pompeii, and one girl was left behind, and we didn't find this out till much later. But she was so smart that since there were many other buses going down to Pompeii, that she got a lift all the way down to Pompeii and then she rejoined the program. So I wish we had had cell phones at the time. Now, I don't know if I'm going on too long, folks, and I can kind of wrap it up.
We are getting near the allotted time.
Okay, so let me just kind of quickly look through some of these things here. And I suppose, one crazy event that took place was when one of our students coming to Rome via London lost his passport on the plane coming from London to Rome. I spent the whole day being in contact with the American consulate, going back and forth, and eventually driving all the way to the airport to give our student a temporary 1 week passport because the police would not let him out of the airport. And it was one of the more challenging moments. And I would have mentioned things about making phone calls or writing back home to our families, both the students' families, but also my family, my wife's family. As many of you remember, it took 2 weeks for the mail to get to the States and 2 weeks to get our responses. And even though nowadays, of course, the cell phones are and Zoom and Skype and all that are wonderful, this wonderful technology. there may be a drawback here, because when students came to Rome at that time, in the early years, they really severed the umbilical cord. Nowadays, the technology is wonderful. I have my sons have been all over the globe, and it's great to be in touch with them. But there's something to be said about really severing that cord and being away for a few months without being in constant contact with family members. In many ways, I think it was it made students find themselves much sooner than perhaps we do nowadays. And I think this is all I have to say, except I will finish by saying that not only I've had a wonderful marital life with my wife and with Trinity College, but I think it was 1981 or 1983, Richard C., one of our students, were waiting for a bus. And he looked at me. I had been there, you know, about three, four years directing. And he looked at me and he told me, "So, Livio, what will you do when you grow up?" I knew what he meant. In other words, you're not going to stop here. You're not going to settle for directing a small program in Rome. And basically, I answered just like in Peter Pan, when I told him, "I'm not sure I want to grow up, because I think I'm a lucky person to be able to live in Rome, study the art that I like, the city that I love, and be in contact with the country that I love, the United States and Trinity College, which has given me so much more perhaps than I've given it." And I'll just finish by saying that I always used to pride myself as being the youngest of the old guard, and now I find myself being the oldest of the young guard.
I'm surprised your hair didn't turn grayer earlier, given some of those stories. You know, one of the things so many of us can say is how much the program changed our lives. I mean, it's changed Henry's research, it changed mine. I got into modern Italian history and wrote a book about Rome. And so many students' lives and direction. I remember students talking about, for example, Franca Kamis is, you know, Franca was an extraordinary teacher and sadly died 20 years ago. But I met a number of students whose whole direction in life was changed by her influence, and the same from some of the other faculty. So this is one of the legacies of Mike Campo, the way in which this program has touched so many people and changed so many lives.
Indeed.
It was just a fantastic transition from being a teacher in the United States to being a teacher in Italy. It just was a transformation that, and I'm reading the comments here as the students write them, that the transformation is almost a given. To be exposed to a culture such as the Italian culture, it was just a gift, I think, to all of us.
Well, it's certainly, I always tell students that you can even go to Timbuktu in the middle of nowhere and stay away for 3 months and come back a different person. Yes. But if you have a great city and a great program to guide you, then I think you're on a good track.
Well, great food too.
So I don't know, it's Stephen, there you go.
Here I am. Hi, so, thank you to the three of you for sharing all of these memories and reflections on the program. And it feels like we were just sort of getting started with the conversation and in the chat, lots of people have identified with the things you've talked about and reminiscing. And so I think we'll have to make a small booklet out of the chats that will come out of this, out of these events, because the first one was great. And these are wonderful too. So thank you to the three of you. I think we might be out of time in terms of a Q&A. There's just one, but which we'll get back to the attendee, maybe privately afterwards or to everyone next event. But I wanted to, after, you know, thanking the three of you, thank everyone for attending today. And I'd like to just remind everyone that next month we're going to continue the journey through the 50 years of the Rome campus history. And in this case, we're going to have an on-site virtual academic tour by a group of Rome campus faculty on April 20th will be the next event. So we'll get that information to you with the exact time and everything, but please join us. You'll see the Aventine from some perspectives that maybe some of them you'll remember and some of them maybe you weren't familiar with. So thanks again to everyone for joining. I think that we'll all say goodbye and we'll close on a slideshow, which many of you probably saw last event, but if you weren't here for the last one, this will be a chance for you to see it now, and you might want to watch it again, even if you saw it last time. So thanks again to everyone, to Borden and Henry and Livio, and thanks for organizing this, Steve Donovan from Alumni Relations. So bye, everyone. Ciao.
E qualcosa rimane fra le pagine chiare e le pagine scure. E cancello il tuo nome dalla mia facciata. E confondo i miei alibi e le tue ragioni. I miei alibi e le tue ragioni. Chi mi ha fatto le carte mi ha chiamato vincente, ma uno zingaro è un trucco. E un futuro invadente, fossi stato un po' più giovane, l'avrei distrutto con la fantasia. L'avrei stracciato con la fantasia. Ora le tue labbra puoi spedirle a un indirizzo nuovo e la mia faccia sovrapporla a quella di chissà chi altro. Ancora i tuoi quattro assi vada bene di un colore solo, li puoi nascondere o giocare come vuoi o farli rimanere buoni amici come noi. Santa voglia di vivere e dolce venere di Rimmel. Come quando fuori pioveva e tu mi domandavi se per caso avevo ancora quella foto in cui tu sorridevi e non guardavi. Ed il vento passava sul tuo collo di pelliccia e sulla tua persona. E quando io, senza capire, ho detto sì, hai detto è tutto quel che hai di me, è tutto quel che ho di te. Ora le tue labbra puoi spedirle a un indirizzo nuovo e la mia faccia sovrapporla a quella di chissà chi altro. Ancora i tuoi quattro assi vada bene di un colore solo, li puoi nascondere o giocare con chi vuoi o farli rimanere buoni amici come noi.
girano in centro sfiorando i 90, rosse di fuoco comincia la danza, di frecce con dietro attaccata una targa, dammi una specie all'estate che avanza, dammi una bella